Dear brethren, beloved young people, thank you so much for joining us in this special week of prayer when we have the privilege to thank the Lord for His protection in this time of crisis and also to pray for those who have been going through sufferings and those who have lost their beloved ones. Today, we are going to talk about the hope for the future, and we'll consider a few ways through which we can prepare a new generation to finish the work that the Lord has given us and also prepare them for the final crisis. But before we open God's word, let us kneel down for prayer. Our beloved Father in heaven, in the precious name of Jesus, we thank you so much for the privilege to speak with you in prayer. We thank you that you have protected us during this time of crisis and that you have given us time to spend with our families and also to preach the gospel through different means. Lord, bless us as we kneel down before you. Help us to understand the message you have for us today. And we pray, Lord, especially for those who have been suffering during these times and also for those who have lost their beloved ones. Please be their comfort and give them hope for the future. And help us all to unite our forces to understand the need of salvation and to understand the need of helping others understand and find salvation. Forgive us our sins, Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. I am very thankful to the Lord for the privilege to be able to record this video. About a week ago, I had an accident which prevented me from recording earlier. And I didn't think I would be able to do it. But today, by God's grace, I feel a little better. And even though I am recording from a sitting position, I praise the Lord for this opportunity. And I pray that God will use His word to change our hearts and to help us prepare ourselves and prepare a new generation for the days to come. So today, like I said, we'll speak about the hope for the future. And I would like to begin by some ideas or one idea by which little children judge their parents as they grow up. Now, some of them say, first, they teach us how to talk. Then they teach us how to walk. And as soon as we learn how to do both, they tell us to sit down and be quiet. Now, that sometimes applies to the spiritual life as well. You know, as we prepare young people for baptism, we teach them how to behave, how to be active, how to preach the gospel. And then as soon as they learn how to do both, we kind of let them sit on the bench in the church and we do not give them enough work to do according to the energies they have. So children are thinking that their parents invest in teaching them how to walk and how to talk so they can walk and talk and run when they are a little older. But as they become too active and too noisy, we kind of tell them to not be so active and not be so noisy, right? So the same thing we could do in the church capacity, as young people have a lot of energy and sometimes we cannot keep up with them, we are trying to slow them down a little bit to our pace instead of letting them run. Go and be active. So today we will talk a little bit about how we can cope with this situation and how we can encourage the young people to be active and encourage them to actually finish the work that the Lord has given us. In a way, our job is to prepare a new generation to stand in the final crisis. Now, this situation is not new. I mean, parents telling the children to be quiet. Actually, in the Bible, there is an example in which the leaders of the church were asking the children to be quiet, or at least were concerned that the children were too loud in what they were expressing. So let's read in the Bible in Matthew chapter 21, verse 15. And when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were so displeased. The leaders of God's people back then were concerned that the children were praising the Lord too loudly, or they were too convinced and too active in what they were doing. And they were really afraid, they were really displeased with that kind of energy for the Lord. So it's not new that today we kind of want sometimes the young people to slow down to our pace. But when we were young, the older generation tried to do the same as well, right? Of course, nobody means harm to anybody, but we all need to learn how to help each other, how to help the new generation be active and at the same time be respectful and by God's grace finish the work that the Lord has given us. So not only the leaders of Israel or the high priests were concerned with the children being too active or being too disturbing sometimes, even the disciples of Jesus were a little disturbed by the presence of the children when their parents or others were bringing them to be blessed by Jesus. Well, the disciples were not angry at them, but they thought that Jesus was too busy with the adults to be able to take time for the children. So let's read that text as well in Mark chapter 10, verses 13 and 14. It says, "And they brought young children to him, and his disciples rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and said unto them, Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God." And then he continues in verses 15 and 16, "Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. And he took them up in his arms, put his hands upon them, and blessed them." Now, imagine the reaction of the disciples when they saw that actually Jesus stopped everything he was doing to give attention to the little children. He was not feeling that the children were in his way. He actually gave up on everything he was doing to take time for the children. So today we are supposed to learn from him, and in whatever activities we do, we have to take time to include the children and include the teenagers and include the adults. In today's time, many times when the parents are busy with their visitors, adult visitors, they sometimes keep the children in front of an electronic device or in front of the TV so that they would not disturb the adults. And when children come to ask for a question, parents usually say, "Please, honey, do not disturb me, because I'm busy." But in reality, God is inviting us to quit everything we are doing when our children need our attention, when our children need our support, when our children need a question answered, when our children, in other words, need to be blessed by our attention. Jesus took time for them. He actually was very busy, but he quit what he was doing so he would take care of the children. As we take care of our children, we will be blessed later in life when they make decisions for baptism, when they get busy in God's work, when they can answer for their faith, they will remember that they do know so many things because we as parents took time to teach them, took time apart to spend quality time with them. Our children, according to the verses we just read, stand for the kind of dependence and faith we need to have in God, we as adults, because Jesus said that if we do not receive the kingdom of God as these little children, we will not inherit heaven. So that means that we ought to learn from our children and from the young people in the way they trust God and the way that they trust parents, the way they forget and forgive the wrong others have been doing to them. God wants us to be like those little children if we want to inherit the kingdom of God. So if our children at least teach us dependence upon God and faith in Him, that is enough as far as their importance in our lives and in the life of God's children. If we ever fail in the gospel ministry, it is because we didn't learn faith and trust from the children. Now, the youth have a purpose. They are not supposed to just come to church, listen to the sermons of the adults, and go home. They are not there just to sit in the church and be quiet, right? They have a work to do. And in Counsels to Teachers, page 517, we find an important paragraph for us to understand. It says, young men are wanted. God calls them to missionary fields. Furthermore, young men can more readily adapt themselves to new climates and new society, and can better endure inconveniences and hardships. By tact and perseverance, they can reach the people where they are. Now, one of the things that I noted in this paragraph is the idea that young people can better endure inconveniences and hardships. Now, isn't that what the final crisis is going to be like? Aren't we going to face inconveniences and hardships and persecution? It says that young people are important to God's church because they will be able to continue the work during this time of trials. Now, I know other paragraphs in the Spirit of Prophecy which also speak about the ability of the young people to learn new languages so they can go into foreign mission fields. Now, the young people are very important, and we don't have time to consider everything the Bible and the Spirit of Prophecy teach about the young people, but actually, even children will have a work, will have an important place in God's work in the final days. So, when we invest in our young people, we truly invest in the future of the church, and it's the best we can do. God called Jeremiah, for example, when he was very young, and he was called to make a difference in a time of crisis. Now, he is not the only one who was called in, to make a difference in a time of crisis, but this time the crisis was coming from within God's people. They were going through a time of apostasy, and God called Jeremiah when he was very young to make a difference in the life of God's church, which is very interesting. And now when we read in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, we understand how small, how young Jeremiah was, that he was not even able to accept very easily the task that the Lord had given him. So in Jeremiah 1:5, we read, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations." Now, what God is saying here is that before Jeremiah was even born, before he was young, before he was a child, before he was born, God had already selected him to have a purpose in God's church. Now, Jeremiah is not the only special child. All our children are special, and all our children are known by God before they are born, and they do not come into this world by chance. God had already prepared a work for them to do. But many times, we as parents and as a church fail in our task in bringing up children and young people, educating them, so they will fail in their calling by God because we do not cooperate with heaven. But if we did cooperate with heaven, also the spirit of prophecy states very, very nicely that they would fulfill their task. If we but cooperate with him, he would save our children. Not only will he save the children, but he will work through saved children and young people and teenagers to finish the work God has given us. It is an important work, and God called Jeremiah and assured him that it is not now that I am calling you. You have actually been ordained before you were even born. And this is what God is willing to tell each and every one of us. He is willing to tell our children today, my son, I have known you before you are born, and you are here with a purpose. So God not only blesses our children, but he gives them a job to do. And it is our work as parents and as a church to find those callings in our young people and help them walk in the purpose God has for them. It is a difficult task, but this is what God has called us to do. And this is how we prepare a new generation, by giving our young people enough attention and enough knowledge, encourage them to study God's word, so they will be able to defend the truth when it is necessary. And we see in verse 6 the reaction Jeremiah had. He said, I cannot do this job. And actually, this is the best we can do when God calls us, is to recognize our weaknesses and understand that we cannot do it. But when we say we cannot do it, is when the Lord mostly can use us, because he will then be able to work his miracles in our lives and help us walk in his way and do his work. Now, I touched a little bit on answering this question, but let me ask it again. Why do some of the young people fail to live up to God's calling for them? So why do they not go on and conquer the world as God designed them to do? Now, in Philippians chapter 2, verse 21, we find the answer to this question, or one of the answers to these questions. Again, the question is, why do some of the young people not fulfill the plan or the purpose God has for them? Philippians 2, 21. Let's read. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ's. Now, the reason some of the young people fail to fulfill God's purpose in their lives is because they develop a selfish spirit, a selfish attitude. They invest a lot in themselves and they forget to invest in Jesus Christ, who actually knew them before they were born and were created them with a purpose. They fail to do so because they become too selfish and too focused on themselves. Now, the question is, what makes them get to the point of being selfish or be focused on themselves? And I believe this has a lot to do with the way they are being educated by us as parents. Because we are the same way. We invest in ourselves, we invest in our houses, we invest in what makes us happy temporarily. And sometimes we forget about the things that would make us happy eternally. And so our young people learn from us and they become competitive. So they invest a lot in developing their own personal life and they forget about the kingdom of heaven. And this is why they do not fulfill the purpose God has for them. Now, let's read what the spirit of prophecy says regarding many of the young people today. Let's read in a paragraph from the spirit of prophecy. The majority aim to make a name for themselves in the world. They follow out their own purposes as eagerly as do the world, and thus they cut off their power to help in establishing the kingdom of God. Now, this paragraph is found in Christian Services, page 54, paragraph 2. It says that the majority aim to make a name for themselves in the world. They invest so much in this purpose, as much as the world does, that they cut off the power in establishing the kingdom of God. Now, again, the young people have learned it from somewhere, right? But the majority of the youth today, even Christian youth, are investing in themselves because their idea is to be able to be better off financially wise than their parents. They do not want to suffer. They do not want to go through difficulties. They look around and they compare themselves to other rich people or educated people. So they decide that they will invest everything they have and everything they are in making a name for themselves in the world. And in investing so much in that, they forget about the kingdom of God. Now, of course, I'm not against education. The young people need to be educated, but they need not forget that they are here with a purpose. And that if they do go to study to college or university, they are there with a purpose. They are not there only to invest in themselves, but they are there to represent God. They are there to make a difference because they have been called by God to make a difference. They were born so they can make a difference in the world. So wherever we are, in whatever we invest, we need to have in mind the advancement of God's work and of His kingdom. So the majority of the young people today, according to what we've read, are investing in themselves and they forget the kingdom of God. Now, another paragraph from Testimonies, volume 2, page 624, paragraph 3, says, God's cause must have minutemen who will not be hindered from the work of God or the call of duty by any selfish or worldly interest. The world has come in between you and the work of God and divided your interest. Selfish interest has come into your heart and the power of the truth has been going out. Now, God is calling young people to be minutemen, to be men who would give up on everything to answer God's call. But he says there that the world has come in between young people and God. And God is calling us to make a difference. Now, the Bible also speaks about a young man who did not commit big sins. He did not go into the world, right? But he is considered to have been loving the world too much. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, Paul says, Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world. Now, Demas was a companion to Paul, the Apostle Paul, in his journeys, in his missionary work. And at the point, Demas got discouraged when he saw how many difficulties he was going through, that he decided that missionary work was not for him. Now, according to what I understand, Demas was quite successful, but he got discouraged and he forsook Paul in his missionary trips and probably went back home and took care of his secular life. But Paul is calling that love to the world. You see, when we give up on God's work to take care of our selfish personal interests, God is considering it, or at least the apostle considers it to be love of the world. Not because Demas went to study or went to work in the secular world, but because in doing so, he had forsaken the higher purpose that he had or God had for him, which was to be a missionary. Again, to be a missionary doesn't mean for you to be full-time missionary, to depend on the church for support. Being a missionary means to be a missionary in whatever you do, in your school, in your work, in whatever your vocation is, you can still be a missionary. You can make a difference and you can actually sometimes do more than dedicated full-time missionaries because you can reach out to some classes of people that we as missionaries cannot reach out to. So it is important for you, it is important for the young people to dedicate their lives to God and combine secular work with missionary work rather than dedicating their lives only to secular, because that might be considered love for the world. Now, the question is, we just said that the majority of the young people are selfish, investing too much in themselves and forget about the kingdom of God. The question is, does it have to be that way? You know, today, many times we say that, in our time is difficult to be dedicated because there is so much to do. We are so busy. The world was not like that before. But we actually just read that in the time of Timothy, the majority of the young people were seeking their own, not the things that are Jesus Christ. In Philippians 2:21, we just read this, right? But the next Bible verse gives us hope and tells us that actually it doesn't have to be like that. The young people are not supposed to copy others and do what they do. There could be someone who is different. And in the time of the apostles, there was one who was different, even though Philippians 2:21 says, all seek their own, not the things that are Jesus Christ. Paul actually comes and claims that there was actually an exception when he says in verse 22 from Philippians 2, he says, but ye know the proof of him that as a son with the Father, he has served with me in the gospel. You see, there was an exception to the rule back then, and that exception was Timothy. He was a young man, he was homeschooled, he was very well educated actually. He had a lot of capabilities. He could have been anything he would have wanted. But he chose to sacrifice his secular life for the life to come. He decided to be a co-worker with Paul in the gospel. Isn't that wonderful? So the question is, when today we live in such a selfish time, when we live in a time of crisis in so many ways, not only physical crisis, not only physical suffering, but we live in a time of crisis in every way possible. The question is, can we make a difference today? Can we make an exception to the rule today? So young people, you have a challenge before you. God is calling you to make a difference. Will you accept the call? Now today, God is promising us that he can use us just like he used Timothy. Now let's read this paragraph from Conflict and Courage, page 344. God will use the youth today as he used Timothy if they will submit to his guidance. Now, isn't that wonderful? God promises to be able to use us today as he used Timothy, but there is one thing we are supposed to do, and that thing is to submit our will to his, to submit to his guidance. In order for our youth to be able to make a difference, we have to invest in them as much as we can. Now the question is, when should we start investing in our children? Well, God started investing in Jeremiah before he was born, before he was conceived. Isn't that what we are supposed to do? Invest in our children even before they are born? Well, I always say the education of the children begins with the education of the parents. With that being said, let us read what the Lord is telling us in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 11. And she, Hannah, vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of thine handmaid, and remember me and not forget thine handmaid, but will give unto thy handmaid a man-child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. The point I want to make here is that Hannah promised the Lord that she would give her son to his service, to the service of the temple, if God helped her have a child. And that is wonderful. That is the promise every parent should actually make. Lord, I will dedicate my son or my daughter to your service according to the plans you have for him. In Patriarchs and Prophets, page 561, we read, "The inquiry of every father and mother should be, what shall we do unto the child that shall be born unto us? The effect of prenatal influences has been by many lightly regarded, but the instruction sent from heaven to those Hebrew parents, and twice repeated in the most explicit and solemn manner, shows how this matter is looked upon by our Creator." So that paragraph is telling us that God gave instructions not only to Hannah, but to other parents from the Hebrew families regarding the care they have to take for their children. And he gave them instructions also as to how they need to behave and what they needed to change so that those children could be used by God after they were born. So the education of our children begins with the education of us as parents. And we have a work to do in preparation for having children. So speaking to young families, young couples, dedicate yourselves to the Lord if you really want your child to be dedicated when he is born or she is born. So God has a purpose with our children, but them, in order for them to fulfill that purpose, we need to do our part even before our children are born. Now, the Bible and the spirit of prophecy is actually teaching that the children's dispositions for good or evil are established before they are born. Physical dispositions, emotional dispositions, and spiritual dispositions are influenced before the children are born. You see, so we have to take care of the environment we are going to bring our children into so that they will be fitted to do God's work when they are born and as they grow up. So we have to take care of them before they are born. Now, after they are born, sometimes we keep them in our arms and we are thinking, Lord, what are we going to do with this thing? How are we going to behave? What are we going to do? And we are asking that question a little too late, but, well, not too late, actually. A little late, but not too late, let's say. Because we were supposed to ask that question before they were born. So now that we do have them, it is not too late to ask the Lord for wisdom. So he will guide us in educating our children. So as we keep them on our arms, let's pray to the Lord and say, Lord, here is my son. Here is my daughter. Please do as you please with them. Do what you want with them. And God will use you to bring them up to his honor and glory. So when our children are young, we are supposed to take care of them, to take care of those physical, emotional, and spiritual needs that they have. Even if we neglected our lives in the past, God can still work out a miracle and help our children be useful in God's work and fulfill the purpose God has for them. Now, speaking of taking care of them also when they are young, in Child Guidance, page 26, we read, there is a modern error when parents send their children to school, and when they have done this, they think they have educated them. So what do many parents do today? they send their children to school, so the parents have time to go to work and do whatever they have to do. And then they think, well, my son or my daughter is well educated. Actually, there is a definition to education that I heard someone mention, and that is being supported, of course, by the Bible and spiritual prophecy. It is education is what remains after what has been learned is forgotten. So education is what remains, and that is the character, actually. So that's what education is. I repeat, education is what remains after everything that has been learned is forgotten. So if you forget the theory of the things you have learned, the character will remain, because the education you received is heavenly and not worldly. So in Child Guidance, again, page 26, it says, the work of education and training should commence with the babyhood of the child, for then the mind is the most impressible and the lessons given are remembered. So the education is not only when the children grow enough to go to school. No, education begins early. So that, because the things that they learn when they are early, when they are babies, they are going to remember forever. Now, when our children are small, we have to think of their surroundings, of their education. And actually, according to the Spirit of Prophecy in Child Guidance, page 34, paragraph 1, the ideal schoolroom for our children is nature. The best room you can educate your child in is nature. So, in the surroundings, they can learn a lot. I mean, why would we want to learn from books about nature when we can learn from nature about God? It's amazing how God speaks to us. You see, the environment we bring our children up in is very important. Bringing up a child in the city is different from bringing up a child in the nature, in the country. We don't have time to go through all the details of the importance of educating our children in the country, but you can read a lot in Sister White's writings, how, for example, the children working with the ground is strengthening their immune system. Now, we have learned a lot about the importance of the immune system in this time of crisis, how important it is for us to be able to stand against sicknesses just because our immune system is strong. You know, instead of becoming artificially immune, you'd rather become naturally immune. And the Spirit of Prophecy speaks a lot about how working in the garden can strengthen the immune system, let alone eating from the produce of the garden when it is fresh, when it is natural from your own garden. That also strengthens the immune system. And then the education, the connection with the God of nature through nature is really strong. So God is calling us to take care of our children in this kind of an environment, when temptations are not so strong, where the children can become strong enough to be able to stand the temptations of Satan when they are exposed to them, live in the country and work in the city to save the crowds of people who need salvation. Now, the first textbook is the Bible. You know, from the Bible, you can learn not only about God, but you can learn many sciences that they teach in schools. If you only use the Bible, you can learn a lot about many things. Like I said, we don't have time to mention all of them, but the Bible is actually a manual for life. You can learn a lot about how to live and how to understand mathematics, chemistry, physics from the Bible itself. So God is wonderful. He gave us a manual for our children to learn from. And the first teachers, according to Child Guidance, page 17, the first teachers of our children should be the parents. Not the teachers, not strangers, but the parents themselves should be the first teachers. And we are grateful that United States of America is giving us this privilege to teach our children at home. Of course, they may have some deficiencies because we are not trained teachers, but we'd rather teach our children at home than having them away from home for so many hours in a day. Children in the United States spend more time away from home in schools than at home with their parents. And they will, of course, the children will be more influenced by what they learned from school than what from what by what they learn at home. So we need to prepare our children to do the work God has for them, but we cannot keep compromising their education, hoping that God will make a miracle in their lives. I want to say that God can make miracles, but how much more useful our young people would be if we as parents invested in them the proper way in every stage of their lives. So when our children are small, let's spend time with them. You know, I remember from my experience, because I traveled a lot, I did not spend enough time with my children, and I wish I did spend more time with them. But you see, God, I hope, will work out a miracle in their lives and help me redeem the time as it goes by today. Redeem the time by using today the time properly. Now, when our children are small, take them to nature as much as we can. Now, when they are teenagers, it's the most sensitive time of their lives. So many things change in their lives. Even the way they perceive the world, they are in search of their identity. And it is then when we as parents are supposed to be closer to them, are supposed to be their friends, so that they can be able to stand against the temptation of the teenage years. As parents, we need to take time to spend with them when they are teenagers. Because according to statistics, the majority of the young people decide to get baptized by the age of 14. And a fraction of them make the decision after they are 14, and an even smaller fraction after they are 20, and so on and so forth. So it is important for us to take time for our children when they are teenagers, because it is then when they can easily be confused, when they can easily lose their identity as Christians. So it is very necessary for us to spend time with them, get to know them, get to know what they are going through, and understand their needs instead of criticizing them when they surprise us with a bad behavior, right? Because many times we neglect them, they learn from outside of the home how to behave, they come home, they behave badly, and we react and we criticize them, when we should actually take a break, think about our priorities, and take care of our children rather than other important, as we call them, things. When our young people are teenagers, we as a church need to take care of them as well. And I want to read in the Spirit of Prophecy, Counsels to Teachers, page 43, where it says, as a church, as individuals, if we would stand clear in the judgment, we must make more liberal efforts for the training of our young people, that they may be better fitted for the various branches of the great work committed to our hands. When judgment comes, we will be judged also by how much effort we made for the training of our young people. And he says, as a church, And as individuals, if we would stand clear in the judgment, we would make more, we need to make more liberal efforts for our young people. And truth being said, we kind of neglected this work. And God is calling us today to change that. God is calling us to spend time with the young people, with the teenagers in our church, because they can be useful. They can be our strength. They can be the energy of the church if they are educated according to God's will. They will be the future of tomorrow. So God is calling us today to invest in our young people, to make more liberal efforts to help them, not as cases that need help. No, just consider them equal. Speak with them as if we spoke to adults. Make sure we involve them in our activities. Give them responsibilities, because believe it or not, they love to know that they are trusted by the church and by the ministry. So the more we give them, the more willing they will be to take on responsibilities. Today's youth are amazing. I mean, they go to missionary trips, they pay their own way to these foreign lands, and they spend 2 weeks working hard to make sure the project is successful. They do it spending from their own money and their own time. You see how willing they are to work. What they need is for us to take the initiative, create projects, and give them a lot of work, because they can carry it. They can do the job. Another paragraph from Gospel Workers, page 208, reads, "The youth need more than a casual notice, more than an occasional word of encouragement." So our young people need more than just hello, hi, and bye. They need the personalized attention. They need us to focus on their needs. They need us to really take quality time for them. We as leaders and as parents, they need more than a casual notice, more than one word of encouragement. Even that casual notice, even that word of encouragement is going to go a long way. But imagine taking time, sitting on the grass with them, going to have an activity in nature with them, and just be there for them. That will help tremendously in our relationships. Now, let's come to a conclusion to our study today and understand that God has a purpose for us. God has a purpose for our young people. And if we work unitedly, the experience of the adults and the strength of the young people is going to propel the church forward and help the church, help everyone go forth and finish the work that God has given us. You know, the latter rain will not be falling unless we are active. God is calling us to be active, to make one step forward. And just to conclude this study, I would like to read from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15. "And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again." There is a lot of selfishness. Young people live for themselves. We do the same. And today God is telling us that Jesus died for all, even for the selfish ones. He died for all, that we which live should not henceforth live unto ourselves, but unto him who died and rose again for us. We are bought with a price. We are not ours. We belong to God. Isn't it proper for us to give our lives to his service? The question is it possible in this time of crisis, when we barely survive spiritually and physically, is it possible to live a different life? Is it possible to dedicate ourselves to the service of the Master rather than to secular activities? Is it possible? Well, there is only one way we can do it. And this is found in 2 Corinthians 5:14, the previous verse of the one that we just read. 2 Corinthians 5:14 says, "For the love of Christ constraineth us." Now, is it possible? Well, yes. If we understand how much God loved us, if we understand what the sacrifice He made, not for the world, but for me personally, when we do understand God's love, when we understand the love of Christ, that love will constrain us to live for Him and not anymore for ourselves. So, young people, you are the hope of the future. You are the hope of the finishing of God's work here on earth. The question is, will you choose to dedicate yourself to God today and to His service so you can make a difference? So we will go home from this time of crisis, from this world full of trials and temptations. Are you ready to go home? Are you ready to finish the work God has given you and God has given me? Let's pray. Our beloved Father in heaven, we thank you in the name of Jesus for this wonderful miracle you've done in our lives, to have known us before we were born and to have led us to conversion. And you have given us so much knowledge of the truth. You have given us so many opportunities to share the gospel with others. And Lord, today we want to pray that you may help us to overcome temptations, help us overcome difficulties, help us stand in a time of crisis and make a difference in this world. Please bless our young people, bless the teenagers of our church, bless our children, and bless those who are not parents yet, that they will prepare themselves for the time when they will have children, so that we can educate them, so that we can help them in making good decisions for life eternal, and so that they would be useful and would fulfill the purpose you have for them in their lives. Forgive us our sins. Forgive us for our negligences, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. May the Lord help all of us to have a dedicated week of prayer, and may we all pray for one another so we can stand against the evils of this world, and so we can resist and be able to go through this crisis by God's help. Amen.